753 BC is traditionally the founding date of the city of Rome. It's around then, in other words, in the middle of the 8th century, that Rome starts to become a viable entity in the sense that you're talking about one city rather than a series of small communities dotted around those famous seven hills of Rome. Rome traditionally was founded in that date by two brothers, Romulus and Remus. Romulus and Remus then have a kind of Abel and Cain falling out because they try and found two separate cities, one of them on the Aventine, which is the hill immediately opposite the Palatine, looking down the river, and one of them on the Palatine. Romulus gets the Palatine, Remus gets the Aventine. And they fall out, one kills the other after Remus laughs at the size of Romulus's wall, and Romulus tops him. And thereafter, Romulus starts to develop the city of Rome as a place that's run from the Palatine, but that joins together the other hills. But there's this famous traditional rivalry between the Palatine and the Aventine built in, right there.
Aventine Hill was considered the original working class district of Rome, as opposed to the Palatine Hill, which is where Attia lives, for instance, which is the upper class hill. And the two hills looked at each other across the Circus Maximus.
The Romans really truly were completely masters of the Mediterranean by now. I mean, no one was going to question that. But they were still embarrassed by the fact that their city, quite frankly, didn't look up to the job. It didn't look like the center of a great empire. It was ramshackle, falling down, huge high tenements, all built out of straw and lath and muck. It didn't have any great boulevards. It had one big central public space, the Forum. But at that stage, even that was a bit higgledy-piggledy. And it was Augustus who basically introduced monumental building in great stone, like the great colored stones from Egypt, like porphyry and granite, and then also marble. Those things all started to be introduced into the architecture of Rome after our time.
I am Servilia, of the most ancient and sacred Junii, of whose bones the seven hills of Rome are built.
At the end of the Republic and at the beginning of the Empire, Rome was run by about 30 families, ultimately. They were the most important and powerful people in Rome. And they were constantly rivals. The grandest of all clans was the Claudian clan. The clan that Julius Caesar came from is the Julii. Brutus came from a clan called the Junii.
Mother was always nagging me to attend politics.
Well, it's been our family's tradition and duty for 500 years.
These represent families who have just exerted extraordinary power and control for hundreds of years in Rome.
Generally speaking, you're either extremely rich or extremely poor. So there was a vast divide between the rich and the poor, and they had no social connection with each other, and they constituted two separate classes with a very clean divide between the two. Everyone would know where they stood.
So you're civilian.
Address me by my name again, and I'll have your tongue nailed to a wagon wheel.
Forgive me. I've not spoken to nobility before.
If you were sufficiently upper class, patrician, you didn't do a job at all. So you've got this tiny elite, which is a tiny percentage of the Roman population, who are the patricians, and they live off basically the land, literally, because they own Italy. They own the city and they own the farmland of Italy, and that is the chief source of their revenue. Now, they may do political work in the sense that they're senators or whatever, but they do that free, they do that gratis, they don't get paid for it, and they do it for the honor, for the reputation, for the respect.
A poor person would have to treat a rich person with a great deal of respect, because the law is essentially that might makes right. And a rich person was pretty much able to do as they wished with the poorer class of people.
We need to create more jobs for our citizens.
It will be hugely expensive.
There is evidence to suggest that there was what we would think of as a classic Roman working class, i.e. people who believed themselves to have been born in Rome, to have real Roman blood running in their veins. And they would have called themselves sons of Romulus, the first king of Rome, and Numa, who was a later king of Rome.
Slaves and foreigners to blame. Rome for fucking Romans, eh?
And we know they were deeply resentful of what they saw as bloody foreigners, as people, immigrants, who came in and took their jobs and undercut their work.
Something Mass me down on the Aventine.
Yes, yes, I know. I hear of nothing else.
The gangs will not stop fighting of their own accord. It is too rich a prize. Whoever controls the Aventine controls the docks and the grain supply.
I am aware.
The violence will spread if it is not stopped. The whole city will swift descend into chaos.
Rome was always an extremely dangerous city. I mean, almost unimaginably dangerous. Stepping outside your house, particularly after dark, will involve running the risk of losing your life. In Rome, there was a self-imposed curfew. You just never went out after dark. It became even more dangerous after the assassination of Caesar, simply because the city did become less centrally controlled even than it had been before. And so you would have had street violence even during the day.
Let's take his nose off.
And the main places that we know that they happened were in the main slum, in the Suburra, and also down by the docks.
When Erastes' foreman was alive, there was peace on the Aventine. Now, every gang in the city is fighting for control of the hill.
It's always been part of life that each hill was controlled by a group. Whoever had control of those hills really essentially was reporting to the head consul.
You start a damn war on the Aventine that threatens to engulf the whole fucking city.
One of the single biggest changes that takes place in Roman society at the time that we've set Rome is the rise of what the Romans called collegia, which really means something like guild or trade guild. And anybody who is involved in any particular kind of trade, for example, you might be dealing in the movement of grain, very, very important business, you would join in a guild, and it offered you a degree of protection.
The thing about crime in Rome was that there was no police force, and for the working classes, there was no real functioning court system. You could do whatever you could get away with, and it was essentially legal self-help. If you were strong enough to punish those who had done you wrong, that was the law. The gangs constituted both a criminal class and a kind of rudimentary system of law and order. If you're a working class Roman and someone had done you wrong, you would go to the local gang leader for justice rather than going to a law court or the police that didn't exist.
I hear there is a deal of violence again between the collegia.
No trouble. We may need to bang a few heads together.
Whatever needs to be done.
As long as the rich and the good of Rome weren't victims of theft or larceny or murder and stuff like that, they could do pretty much what they want. They take their share as long as they don't abuse that.
80 of the richest, noblest patricians for you to murder and then rob. What shall we do with all this wealth?
But under the pressures of the civil war in Italy, and particularly in Rome, they started to be hijacked for other purposes, and they effectively became fronts for organized crime.
Son of Hades!
When Varinus destroys the Statue of Concord, it's both a sacrilegious thing and an assertion that the power of his gods are larger than the power of Concord. He's allying himself with Hades, who is the god of the underworld, an extremely powerful god that in the normal course of conversation you would be very reluctant to even mention his name.
A demon has possessed you, or I don't know what.
You see, a demon!
As far as we can tell with poorer Romans, they believed this stuff as we might see it. In a way that we might almost regard as superstitious, in that they didn't feel that they could do anything, they couldn't go through any part of their day without paying obeisance to the appropriate god, in a way that had become completely instinctive to them.
The Greek-educated upper classes, who were steeped in Plato and Aristotle, took a very skeptical view of religion.
There was inevitably slightly more cynicism among rich Romans than there was among poor ones.
They would go through the rituals, and they were very strict rituals, but no well-educated man believed in Jupiter and Juno as human-type figures that lived in the clouds. Amongst the lower classes, it was still extremely strong.
The gods have me vexed over Varinus. Can't go on until I sort things out with them.
It was far more of a folk religion, literally magical ways of doing things to call upon the various gods to help you. It was a give-and-take system. They didn't worship the gods in the sense that we think of as worship, because it was much more of a bartering activity.
Look here, Mars. I am Titus Pullo. These bloody men, my gift to you.
It was assumed at that folk religion level that the gods were competing with each other.
Each of the gods or goddesses in this gigantic pantheon, and I mean gigantic, it's thousands of gods and goddesses, each one has his or her own special role to play in keeping your life sweet, on the right side of the bad, on the right, on the sunny side of the street, and if you pay them the right attention, that's where they'll keep you.
The state rituals, complex but kind of fossilized versions of older folk rituals that have become part of the government system and would be done religiously on all the festivals and important days of the year, but very ceremonial. The augurs, who were the very important priests who had to take part in any fresh undertaking by the government or the army, by this period in the late Republic, were very much used as a political tool.
A priest was really a politician. Flip him around, he's a politician. Look this way, he's a politician. Turn around, he's a priest.
What's the hat for?
Yom Kippur.
Ah, is that today? You call yourself a Jew?
And there've been Jews in Rome 250 years before the birth of Christ.
The Jewish community was quite sort of substantial during that period, but there was a lot of immigrants in Rome.
The Jewish population of Rome, they've been there since Judea had been taken over by the Romans. They were a merchant and trading class.
So you're selling spices?
Spices, cloth, oil, thank you.
The Romans were very tolerant about other people's religions. What the Romans thought was strange was Jews only had one god.
Prince Herod, Tetrarch of Galilee, has come to the city. By order of the triumvirate, during his residence here, all mockery of Jews and their one God shall be kept to an appropriate minimum.
The crucial thing the Jews didn't do was they didn't evangelize. So while they were conscious, the Romans, of there being this new kind of religion in their midst, they got a sense of that monotheism, but because it wasn't an evangelistic monotheism, that sense hadn't really truly struck home.
It was the political rebellion that was the friction, not the belief in one God. The Jewish people were very strongly against Roman rule. There was a class of Jewish noblemen, of whom Herod was part, who saw a great deal of benefit to being part of the larger Roman Empire economically and politically.
Tell me more about my father.
Bad gambler, though he'd never admit it.
Gambling, probably the single biggest obsession in popular Roman culture. And the funny thing about gambling is that it actually traverses the boundaries of class.
Gambling in the Forum was frowned upon because you're surrounded by the political and religious center of Rome, but wasn't illegal in any larger sense than that.
We know from Suetonius's life of Augustus, Emperor Augustus, hugely into gambling, and he would gamble on anything. He would gamble on a game that was a bit like scissors, paper, stone, called Mora, gamble on that. Gamble on dice, loved a dice throw. Gamble on knuckle bones. Then you could move on to the races, which was the other massive Roman obsession. I mean, we always talk about gladiators, but gladiators, very occasional kind of entertainment in Rome. The races was a much more regular thing, played out in a huge stadium, the Circus Maximus, which was far bigger capacity than the Colosseum. And it was an obsession for Romans of all different classes as well.
Good stuff.
Is it? What are you doing?
We're inhaling hemp.
Over time, because it was such a cosmopolitan place, all kinds of foreign notions emerged in society.
You know, we know that opium was used. It was almost certainly mainly drunk in a form of, like, you know, laudanum is a form of opium prepared tincture drink. And it was drunk in something that was called cretic wine, wine treated with opium resin. And the opium was grown in Egypt for the most part.
Well, the main drug in use was wine. Wine was extremely common, obviously. Opium and hemp were more of an exotic import from the East.
These sorts of activity did pretty much cover the range of poor Romans and rich Romans. But you needed to be cosmopolitan to try them. For your average born on the Aventine, true blood Roman, there probably would have been something a little bit sophisticated and exotic and a bit suspicious about that form of narcotic taking.
What's the matter with everybody?
There was graffiti all over the city of various kinds, because without television and newspapers, graffiti was one of the major forms of communication.
Graffiti is another of the things that it kind of crosses all classes in Roman society. For starters, you had professional graffiti writers, and you could hire a graffiti writer. But the services graffiti writers were hired by people right the way from the poor to the very, very rich. But the majority, the largest number of graffiti relate to prostitution, either advertising the wares of a prostitute or else quite often simply saying, if you want a good time, you should go see so-and-so who lives in such and such a place. And that kind of graffiti is all over, so that we know prostitution was very, very widespread in the Roman world.
Who are you then?
Slave of the college brothel. I would buy 3 bells.
Sorry, love, with plenty of whores.
Obviously, the whole Roman attitude to sexuality is radically different from our own, primarily because the Romans lived in a pre-Judeo-Christian world. So they didn't have any of the baggage that we attach to sexual expression. And they just saw sexuality as another human urge that needed to be satisfied in the same way as thirst or hunger.
Fidelity wasn't really a moral issue at that particular point in time.
Bisexuality was much more acceptable as well. It was kind of no big deal.
Next time you want a boy, buy one at the market. Any fool knows not to pick one up from the streets.
Thank you, Domino.
They didn't really have the concept of homosexuality. There is no Latin word for homosexuality.
Homosexuality was entirely acceptable if you were the dominant partner.
It's not what you do with somebody that matters. It's who you do it with.
If a man of influence was discovered to be the passive partner in a homosexual relationship, that would be a cause for scandal and dismay.
So in other words, if you are a rich Roman male, you can do absolutely anything you want with whomever you want, as long as you're the person who holds the power. It's really about power more than it's about sex.
Niobe would only want her married to a decent man, and no decent man would have her.
But she could marry, if you would let her.
What kind of man would marry a prostitute?
Amongst men, it was purely a matter of choice and taste, really. A noble woman might object to her husband having an affair with another woman of a similar class, but it would be unlikely she would object to him having a favourite slave, for instance, that he would go to.
Be jealous, Flower?
Of course. I don't mind your whores, but I don't want you making love to her sort.
Meaning younger women of higher rank than you.
Roman women were supposed to appear not to have any sexual appetite. A very respectable Roman woman was meant to, like, not show any signs of enjoyment at all.
Just get up!
I am not rising from this bed until I've fucked someone.
Fine, fine, Marilla. Fetch that German slut from the kitchen.
If you overdid it, then there was a Roman attitude that indulging yourself too much sexually was actually, and interestingly for us, a sign of being less of a man rather than more of one. Because the big Roman thing was that you had control over yourself.
We are seconds to the consul now. We should not be in such places.
Stay. It gets so much better.
At this period, what we call orgies or bacchic rituals were illegal, and they occurred, but very much underground as part of secret religious societies. What we think of now as these debauched orgies that happened all the time in ancient Rome did happen, but much later, when essentially it's a factor of the powerlessness and the boredom of a large, extremely wealthy, but powerless ruling class. The Republican period, they still clung to the old Republican ideals of dignity and stoicism, military values, almost Puritan values in a sense.
It is the women of Rome, like the she-wolf that suckled Romulus and Remus, who have raised a nation of wise statesmen and invincible warriors. I shall enact laws that reward fertility and sanctity in marriage. I shall enact laws that severely punish adultery, promiscuity, and vice of all kinds.
The Romans, ultimately exhausted by over 100 years of civil strife, will do anything just for the pain to stop. And that's the reason they accept Octavian, Augustus, as the first emperor. They don't call him Rex, that Latin word for king. Even at that stage, they couldn't bring themselves to do that.